All right, welcome everybody to Tuesday, January 10th, Board of Selectmen's meeting. I'll read the agenda. 7 o'clock, we'll have citizens input. 7:05, Police Chief Baker do a presentation on the evidence room audit. 7:15, Town Manager, approval, disapproval of Fire Chief's contract. 7:20, Personnel Board, presentation of policies by Personnel Board for consideration and adoption. 7:30, public hearing at the kitchen. Stephen Finergian, vote, discuss, and new annual all-alcohol restaurant license, common VIX license, and entertainment license. 7:40, Selectmen's update. 7:50, Town Manager's update. 8 o'clock, Assistant Town Manager's update. And we'll roll right into action items. Chief Baker, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Being 7 o'clock, is there anybody here for citizens' input? Seeing none, move right into our 7:05. Chief Baker. And I think this is your first official presentation to the board as chief.
I regret to mention this, but this is my second appearance, and my first one didn't go so well, if you remember the medical crisis that occurred.
Well, we try to forget that one.
I'm hoping for a better result tonight.
We have a small audience tonight. Steve, you're feeling pretty good, right?
The guy behind him, I'm worried about.
All right. So I'm going to just introduce this item for you, and the chief, and typically this happens in the transition of a police administration, going from one community to the next, when there's a change in the administration of the chief, that there is an audit that's performed of the evidence room to determine if in fact everything's accounted for. And as we know, there hasn't been a change in this administration for over 30 years. So this was an opportunity to kind of take a look at that and to see where we lie with that. So the chief undertook this process and worked with an outside firm, along with his staff, including Lieutenant is here tonight, to talk about and to view this process and to come up with what, you know, the findings were. So in short, I'll just read the report into the record, and it says that the Foxboro Police Department underwent a transition in leadership on October 3rd, 2016, when I was appointed as your new chief. In the spirit of transparency and accountability, we've conducted an internal and external audit of our evidence and property handling room. I am pleased to report that we have discovered no irregularities during the past 10 years. I wanted to provide you with some synopsis of the findings in each major category. First, an area of drugs. Auditors reviewed 620 pieces of drug evidence listed in as being in our possession, with all items examined and accounted for. We uncovered 22 pieces of mostly trace drug evidence listed as stored or pending destruction from the period of 2002 to 2006 that could not be accounted for. It should be noted that in 2002 we changed our evidence and property management software. We also went through a physical move to our new building in 2008. It is possible that the software change and physical move complicated the tracking of some property and evidence in our possession. It should also be noted that none of the 22 cases involved incarcerated individuals, nor cases with appeals pending, as confirmed by the district attorney. With respect to firearms, we reviewed a total of 19 pages of firearms and evidence containing 62 items, with all items examined and accounted for. In cash, our cash audit from current cases showed all cash accounted for. We did discover 6 cash entries from the period of 2002 in 2006 that we could not account for, totaling $1,683. Although our performance in this area was exemplary, as well, we will implement a new policy for handling currency that comes into our possession in accordance with the recommendations from the auditor and to ensure compliance with municipal finance law. Property non-evidentiary. We examined 33 pages of general property containing 315 property items said to be in our possession. 309 items were examined and accounted for. We have concluded that 6 pieces of personal property with limited monetary value and no evidentiary value were unaccounted for. In conclusion, we appreciate the support provided to this office by Office of District Attorney Michael Morrissey. We are committed to transparency and accountability, and we provide you with the results of our audit in this spirit. The new department administration is committed to making full use of our IMC software platform to improve the accountability of our evidence and property control. We have charted a course to properly train and train all department personnel in the use of IMC to track evidence and property. In December of 2016, we rewrote our evidence and property handling policy. We are creating a new department structure to clarify roles and responsibilities with respect to all high risk and high liability operations, including the handling of evidence and property. We have also assigned a single evidence and property control officer and established a program of regular audits to ensure the integrity of this process. Our evidence and property control personnel will receive state-of-the-art training in March in cooperation with the district attorney's office. My goal is to make the department an industry leader throughout Massachusetts and New England, and one of the models for best practices in every phase of our department operations. Signed, Chief William Baker. So, Chief, if you want to add a few thoughts about the report.
Yeah, the only significant thing I'd like to add is to give credit where credit is due. I think it's important to note that Lieutenant Noonan and Lieutenant Hannon, and particularly Officer Scott Taggart, are the people that undertook the internal audit in anticipation of my arrival. And when I arrived and we discussed the process that they had undertaken, we heard from Michael Morrissey, the DA, who had indicated that there was funding available to conduct external audits. And we concluded as a team that it was a good idea to bring in that external audit entity. It was a private resource, and did that. And between the work that was done internally and the work that was done externally, we produced the report that we provided you tonight. There are some procedures and some policies that we have begun to improve, some training that we can improve and build on. I think the restructuring of the department to clarify lines of responsibility and accountability will be important for all aspects of our operation. But I think the report is a good news report. And again, in the interest of transparency, we wanted to share that with you and make you aware of the results.
So again, this is pretty common in terms of this process, but again, it hasn't happened in quite some time. So I'm really pleased that that the practices that have been handled over the number of years, and the new practices that are being adopted are all in full compliance and best practices, in compliance with the laws of the Commonwealth. So questions from the board?
Yeah, I actually have a couple of questions. How often, other than a change of administration, should an audit take place?
Well, our policy will require a number of things. We'll be doing quarterly audits, an annual major audit, and then we'll be doing surprise audits also. So it'll be a combination of two versions of regularly scheduled and one unannounced audit.
And then how long do you need to keep evidence, whether it's part of a court proceeding or not, and how do you dispose of it?
Well, it depends on the category of evidence. So drug evidence needs to be kept until a defendant has had their case concluded and adjudicated, and that could mean as a result of a trial and a series of appeals. And so we always rely on the district attorney's office to determine when a case has been fully adjudicated and evidence can be destroyed in the drug category. And once the DA makes that determination, then we have a process in cooperation with the state police and the crime laboratory for disposing of narcotic evidence, and do so through those entities that have that narrow responsibility. With respect to other kinds of property, cash, same thing would be true. Much of the cash that comes into our possession as a result of some kind of drug seizure or drug forfeiture. And again, there's a very clear statutory procedure that you need to go through to in order to have the cash forfeited to the community, and generally a split between the community and the DA's office. And in that case, once the forfeiture proceeding is acted on and signed off by a judge, the money becomes the town of Foxborough and goes into the general fund for use as the administration and the selectmen determine. For the third category, which is kind of guns and general property, again, the statutory requirements on how long you have to keep things and what you do with it. In the case of guns, I've always been a proponent of not exercising at least one of the options that are available to people, like turning guns over to gun shops, for example, selling them to gun shops, and taking the cash from the gun sale and putting it in our coffers, because I've always been concerned about where that gun's going to end up once it gets sold to somebody and then maybe stolen in a house burglary or whatever. So we destroy the guns, as we have done recently with guns that were no longer required to be kept. And in the case of personal property, there are some examples like bicycles and other things that are typically auctioned in accordance with a statutory scheme. Otherwise, they're returned to the owner, or if they have no owner and they're of no value, they'd be destroyed again through the various destruction options that are available to us.
Thank you. Through the chair, just a quick question. So reading the report, it looks like you went, well, moving forward, you're going to do quarterly and perhaps yearly audits.
Yes.
Do I understand this correctly that you went back 10 years for your audit?
We went back actually longer than that. It was the period of 2002 to 2006 where some irregularities were noted.
Okay.
But I think it's fair to say that we, the audit, both internal and external, looked at stuff that had been in our possession longer than that 10-year period.
Okay. So between 2002 and now, are you saying there was no audits done, or did you audit during a time that there were also audits done?
I am not aware of any audits, and I know Lieutenant Noonan has been with the department a lot longer than my salty old 12 weeks, so maybe Rich can speak to that.
There was smaller audits, not to this scale that we just went through. It was a complete audit comparing the years within our computer system as well as comparing what we currently have in our property room. This was a full-scale audit of every piece of property that we had within the department.
Okay. Very good. Thank you.
I just have one. Does the state require periodic audits, or is that just something that the individual police departments take on?
Yeah, I expect after some recent very public concerns that we may get to that point, but currently it is not mandated by statute. Mm-hmm. But best practices are, you know, in the industry, something we're aware of, obviously, and something that was recommended to us as a result of this audit. So we take an issue like handling of cash. We'll be following the recommendations and making sure that we comply with best practices. But they are recommended best practices, and they are policy, not statute.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I'm all set.
Okay. Yeah, for the questions. Right. So do you need a vote for the board to accept it, or is it just a provided report?
Unless the board would like to take a vote, I think we don't need a vote, but we thank you for letting us share this information with you. And if I may say, just as a little departure, I think I'm 90 days in, and I just want to thank the board and the administration for giving me this extraordinary opportunity and the people of Foxboro. It's been a real pleasure for the first 90 days, and I think we're on a very good road. And lots of good things are going to happen in the future. So thank you again for this opportunity. Good to see you all.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Thanks, Chief. Thanks, Lieutenant.
Thank you.
We'll have a schedule, but we can take approval, disapproval of Fire Chief's contract. Open that up.
So so the board has been working with us on the renewal of the Fire Chief's contract. I have summarized, I sent a summary to the board just of the changes that I went through the contract by section and provide that to you as of yesterday. So at this time, all I have to do is get a vote of approval. I'm recommending approval of this contract at this time.
Okay. Yeah, move to approve Fire Chief's contract.
Second. Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye. All right, thank you.
That was
congratulations.
Tough
prepared mind is a good thing, right?
We've had several meetings on it. Right?
Yes, sir.
Thank you guys very much for your support
and
support
to
the department.
Okay.
Thank
thanks,
you, Chief.
Thank congratulations. You, Chief. Chief, we have to have you sign that, but I'll have the board sign it tonight. I'll give it to you tomorrow. Okay?
Thank
you very much. Thank you.
Are you here for the personnel board?
Sure.
Did you want to take Steve first? Or is
yeah,
it
yeah,
it's a public
fine.
Hearing, though.
It's a public hearing?
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry about that.
And
okay.
I promise I'll be brief.
I would have loved
leave
to.
You sitting here. That's
I promise I'll be brief. I am the
no,
sole representative this evening.
We got a fill here.
Okay.
All right.
I'm the sole representative this evening of the personnel board due to travel and illness. So I'm pleased to present to you I sent you five policies that showed the previous language and the current language. And just for the benefit of those people who are new to the process, the town has always had personnel policies, but they've been encased within a personnel bylaw. This became problematic whenever a law or a policy changed. The entire bylaw had to go to town meeting on a year-by-year basis. And then in addition, two groups that were covered by this bylaw, which covered most all of our employees, unionized into steelworkers and dispatchers, leaving approximately 15 people left covered by this bylaw. So when the personnel board was reconvened after a long hiatus around the beginning of 2015, we studied the idea of a standalone bylaw that was that defined a personnel system, personnel policies, and procedures for administration. In May, that became a reality when a consolidated personnel bylaw was approved by town meeting. And all that did, I gave you a copy of that as well. It's a bylaw saying there will be a personnel system, there will be policies, this is how we administer them, and it outlines all of that for us. So since May of 2016, in light of that being approved on town meeting, the personnel board has been systematically reviewing and revising policies to meet the changing legal requirements. We're trying to streamline language. I think I've mentioned it here before, for continuity of administration, so that a lot of our language matches across collective bargaining agreements and policies. It just becomes very difficult to administer some of these things when every single group has a different set of rules. So we're trying to mirror some of that language and maybe even introduce some new language in these policies that will get carried over to collective bargaining agreements. So tonight we're presenting you with five revised policies. In accordance with the personnel bylaw, the way they define it, the personnel board met on had a public meeting on December 20th. They reviewed and recommended these five policies. Tonight we're presenting them to you for adoption in accordance with the bylaw. We decided, rather than hit you with, you know, 50 policies, that we'll bring them to you in increments so that they can be digested and reacted to. So the first policy that you should have in front of you on the board docs is a bereavement policy. The policy has been reworded, but the amount of leave entitled to an employee who has a death in their immediate family has been unchanged. What we did edit was to reflect the FMLA definition of what a family member is. We wanted to remain legally compliant and non-discriminatory. So when the FMLA changes the definition, the Department of Labor changes the definition of a family member, it'll stay reflected in our bereavement policy. Did anyone have any questions on that one?
I had a question on the FMLA.
Okay, that one, we're doing that one in 1 second. Because probably a lot of questions are going to come up on that one. The next one was court leave, so there was no change to this policy. The language in this policy is also standard across all of our collective bargaining agreements. So this one truly reflects what we're hoping to do with all of our policies, that things mirror one another. The third one is a little more complicated. It's the statutory family, medical, and parental leave policy. And hopefully this might answer your question, David. So we edited this one to include the new Massachusetts parental leave law. So that used to be called the Massachusetts maternity leave law, and then it changed. So rather than spelling out in this policy the whole FMLA and the whole MPLA, we provide a link to the FMLA website and the state website so that employees can always see a current version of the law. So our idea is not only will these be in a binder, but they'll also be electronic. So you can always search and they can remain updated. This also helps us so that we don't have to keep coming back to you if FMLA changes a language or mass parental leave law changes one term. We don't have to keep coming back to you to change the policy. Another addition was made, and it helped when I took my position here and we started, working with a lot of people on FMLA. We had to designate a rolling calendar year so the people, we knew how we were going to count people's time. We also clearly had to define that their leave was going to be used concurrently. So if someone was on sick leave, you don't get your sick leave, exhaust that, and then take your FMLA. So we put some provisions in the law for using all of your leaves concurrently with the FMLA. And then this policy, as we negotiate contracts, we're going to do the same thing. We're not going to spell out the FMLA and all the contracts. We're just going to put a link in there so that they remain updated. So again, this is another attempt at uniformity. So did any of that help answer your question?
Not even close.
Okay.
So the question is, individuals on designated FMLA leave shall be required to update their status every 30 days.
Yes.
What happens if they don't?
We have a letter that addresses that they can be in violation of our policy or a job abandonment or, you know, any of those things.
I mean, is that grounds for termination?
I think in some situations it could be. A lot of things happen in that, you know, a lot of times it might not be the employee's fault. The medical provider who has to fill out the form, sometimes they stay in a pile. So as long as we keep an ongoing dialogue and we can track down the information, mm-hmm. then, you know.
Yeah, I mean, just, you know, we've had issues where someone will go on FMLA and then they'll just go radio silent and they'll disappear. Mm-hmm. And then it's up to you to
That's
try and track
common.
Them down. And,
yep.
you know, then, yeah. then you know, the excuses start, well, I didn't know I had to communicate.
Yeah.
Of course you do.
Yeah. Our letter very clearly states that. And, you know, we do tell department heads not to reach out to the employee, that I'll be the point of contact for them, and we do stay on it.
So there's one designated point of contact throughout mm-hmm. the whole process?
Right.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That answered
my question.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. I'm glad. The next policy that we have before you is an overtime policy. And formerly, the town had a definition of an overtime policy that if someone worked in excess of their regular schedule, and if they were a seven-hour employee and they worked 7 hours in 1 minute, they'd be entitled to overtime. What we've done in this policy is to adopt the FLSA definition of overtime, which is 40 hours in a week. So it doesn't matter if you work 7.5 hours one day and then 6 hours the next. If it totals 40 hours, there's no overtime. So we have now a definition that meets the federal standard. It's consistent with Fair Labor Standards Act, but for the non-exempt employees. It also eliminates the comp time provision that we had in this policy, which can be problematic because it's sort of an unfunded liability that when someone retires or resigns, they can present you with all of this documented comp time and the town owes it. So mm-hmm. we eliminated comp time. There's one group that still gets comp time, and that's the DPW when it's emergency snow removal. Sometimes they can take a day instead of an overtime shift, taking overtime for it. But so we're now compliant with FLSA on our overtime policy.
Are employees aware whether they're exempt or not exempt?
We're just working on, with the two compensation studies that we've done, we're now reviewing all of the job descriptions for exempt and non-exempt status. So every one of our job descriptions will have at the bottom, you know, what grade it is, what if it's a union or non-union, if it's exempt or non-exempt, and what the number of hours are. We're clearly defining that, so you could tie it back. If you looked at one of our salary charts, you would know right where the position was, you know, whether non-exempt. So we're trying to match all of our documents so that they're pretty transparent. When I came here, there weren't a lot of matching documents, so we're working on that.
The Fair Labor Standards Act event, and there was amendments to the act too, that but they were just recently postponed, right?
Right. They were supposed to go into effect in December, and there's been right now a 6-month wait on those. But we had our HR counsel in to a personnel board meeting, and we have a consultant who looked at all. We redid all of the job descriptions in house to save money. But we had a consultant look at them and HR counsel review them for exempt versus non-exempt status. So although we did the bulk of the work, we did have another set of eyes look at them.
And that status will be communicated with the employees?
Yes. So we have right now all the job descriptions, mm-hmm. like for the steelworkers, are in draft form. And when the compensation plan gets presented, then the job descriptions get finalized. Okay, so any other questions on overtime? The final policy that we're bringing to you tonight is regarding sick leave, sick bank, and sick buyback. These are three really kind of policies that really took a lot of time for us to review. It should be stated that, you know, Personnel Board was great. They did their homework. They talked about these policies. They commented. We reviewed them several times each. And we had Jack Dolan, who's our HR counsel, attend the meetings, too, to advise us on a lot of these things. So the language that you see here took a lot of work, but we're pretty proud of it. So for this group, the bylaw group, we have reduced sick accruals from the standard of 2 days per month to 1.75. So there's a reduction. And this was preceded by all of our collective bargaining agreements that had 2 day per month sick leave accrual. We were able to negotiate those down. So now we felt that the non-union people should match what we did with the union people. There was also a provision that if someone used all their sick leave, was out sick, they came back, all they had to do was work 2 weeks and then they'd get some 5 days of sick leave restored. And we just felt like with all of the generous benefits that was, there's other ways to accomplish sick time. So we removed that from this policy. So you no longer get restored after you come back.
How long had that been?
That was in the bylaws for a very long time. Yeah. We changed the fitness for duty certification. We always required we could require a doctor's note if you were out 3 days or more. Now we put in there a fitness for duty certification because sometimes someone thinks they're well enough to come back and they're not, or they have a note that says they're not and we think they are, so we can send them for a fitness for duty. And it's also consistent with the FMLA language, so that all matches now. With regard to coordination of sick leave and workers' comp, people now have, it's very clear to them that if you're out on workers' comp, you get 60% of your pay, which if you're a 5 day a week person, that's equivalent to like 3 days of work. So we, to make the employee whole, they'd get paid 2 days per week of their own sick time. That wasn't always the practice. So that's how it's done now, and it's explained in here. And that's consistent across all our collective bargaining agreements that have workers' comp. We've spelled that out. Police and fire are covered under a different statute. Edits were made to the sick bank language that you have in front of you. There always was a sick bank. It's never been used, to my knowledge, with this group of bylaw employees. But if someone wants to participate in a sick bank, that's, you know, you've used up all your time and you go to the bank and ask if you can have 30 donated days. We've made the provision that you need to be, in order to be a part of the sick bank, you have to donate time. So you have to sort of like pay into it to be a member, to use the benefit. And that's a change. We've changed the constitution of who the board is that they would go to. It's now two of their peers, which is two of the bylaw employees and a member of the personnel board. I'd be the point of contact to ensure that, you know, HIPAA compliance was maintained. This sick bank language is now in the police and library contracts. It's consistently the same sick bank. It's funny, it's one of those benefits that since I've been here, it's only been used twice in one department, never used it in library, but it's good to have.
And Beth, if you participate in the sick bank and then you leave, and what happens to these?
Those are donated days, so you don't pay them back, but you don't get paid out those days either. So if we grant you 30 days and you quit after you used five of them, you don't get paid out those 25 days. They go back to the bank. Mm-hmm. So that's also in here. We changed that. That wasn't spelled out. The most significant change, and I'm nearing the end of this, is the sick leave buyback. As you know, town employees have the benefit of sick leave buyback when they retire. And we have, in this policy, suggested that we eliminate that for anybody hired after June 30th, 2017. So, you know, that's something going forward that's very, very costly to the town. You have a long-term employee, and, you know, can be tens of thousands of dollars of cash out. So that's one of the changes in this policy. And then finally, the maximum accrual for sick leave has been changed to 264 days in this policy and in all collective bargaining agreements. We had maximum sick balances that were much higher in some of our contracts, and we have consistently cut back to that number. And finally, to Jenny's point, the final clarification in this policy excludes any time borrowed from the sick bank in your retirement calculation. So you don't get paid out those days that you borrow. Were there questions on sick, bank, buyback, or sick leave? Okay. So on behalf of the Personnel Board, first of all, I'd like to thank them for their hard work on this. And we'd like to request that the board approve and adopt these five policies to be included in the Town of Foxboro Policy Handbook and in accordance with the bylaw kept on file with the town clerk.
Yeah, move to accept the five policies. Word that again, move to accept the policies and adopt.
Approve and adopt these five policies.
These five policies.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye. Thank you very much.
Thank you. consistent with what our constant review of policies. I was reviewing through our vehicle use policy earlier this week, and I noticed that there was no mention of how we mark vehicles, which is something that, you know, from time to time comes up. So I'm going to be going back and looking at that issue and see how we can address that consistently, because it's a bit of an inconsistency around the town. I want to see if we can try and put some consistency to that piece. All right, create, so I'll be coming back to that.
We're going to create a template.
I'd like to get a template, yeah, a template, and then also identify which vehicles should be marked, which shouldn't be marked, you know, so we're clear on that piece, because that's really important mm-hmm. to all of us. Yeah. So we want to be sure that there's clear definitions of that. And I thought for sure we had one, but we didn't. We don't have one. So.
And not to reinvent the wheel, we're going to look at what other towns, you know, what their standard practices are, so that we can remain consistent, and we'll report back.
So just an informational piece, an FYI. Okay.
We killed enough time. We can open up public hearing.
Actually, 2 minutes over. That's pretty good.
The Board of Selectmen, acting as the local licensing authority pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 138, will conduct a public hearing on Tuesday, January 10th. 2017, beginning at 7:30 p.m. in the Foxborough High School Media Center, 120 South Street, on the application of an annual all-alcohol restaurant license, common vic license, and entertainment license for Kitchen Partners, LLC, DBA The Kitchen, on 8 Mechanic Street, manager Jennifer Meckler. All interested parties are welcome to attend.
Would you like to come up to the table? And for the record, I just want to disclose that Mr. Glazer and I went to high school together. So we haven't seen each other in probably 30 years.
So who looks better?
So I'd like to disclose I'm in a butter. Huh? I'd like to disclose I'm in a butter.
It's okay. Welcome.
Thank you.
So what are we doing?
So we're here today seeking an all alcohol license for our restaurant at 8 Mechanic Street. It's going to be called The Kitchen. It's a planning on having a family-friendly bistro and craft beers. And we'd like to open potentially by April if we can. We waited for some time for the town to get these extra licenses, and you know, we've been looking at this since summer, and we're finally here after a long wait. So
how are the renovations going?
Going well. We'll after tonight we'll plan on going full bore. The exterior is done. My landlord's here tonight, and he's made quick work of that, so we'll go after the interior.
And what type of food are you going to be serving?
It's going to be an American bistro. Comfort food. That's our plan. Our chef, Jennifer, she's not here. She's traveling in Europe. She goes away every year in January for culinary training. This year, she's traveling a couple different countries. But she's put together a pretty interesting menu. We think everybody's going to be pretty comfortable coming in and enjoying, you know, kids, families. That's our target.
Okay. Any questions from the board?
Yeah, hours of operation.
So for right now, we're not looking at doing lunch. So we're looking at like a 4 o'clock opening. Mm-hmm. And in my experience in the suburbs, by 9:30, it's pretty much done. So I think we'll probably, I think we're looking for an 11:30 cutoff. But I think realistically, mm-hmm. it's going to be earlier than that.
Seating for how many?
I believe we've got 90. That was the number, yeah.
Will there be a separate bar area, or will that just...
The bar is in the main dining room.
It's going to be in the main dining room.
It is, yeah. But we do have a private dining room in the front of the building mm-hmm. for people that want to have get-togethers for, you know, 12 to 14 people.
Okay.
So that's existing. That's there now. And, yeah, that's our plan.
Okay.
This is the time of the hearing where I have to mention Foxcares.
Sure.
Are you familiar with Foxcares?
I am. I was... Marcia had sent that to me. So I did take a look at that. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. There's a meeting tomorrow at 2:30 at Skipjack's, in case you're interested.
2:30, okay. I'll try to make that. Potentially, I might be able to do that.
It's a really conscientious group.
Okay.
Where you're a new license holder in town.
Sure.
They can help you through the ins and outs of the town. They share best practices, tip certification, where to go. They share best practices on false IDs. They work with the ABCC. They work with the district attorney's office.
Sure.
So it's...
they meet monthly, right?
Quarterly.
Quarterly, okay.
Yeah, they meet quarterly.
Got it.
But it's a good group. You get to know the other...
Absolutely.
License holders,
oh, no
stakeholders
question.
In town.
Absolutely.
So it's strongly suggested
sure.
that you participate.
And I'll make sure our attendance is there.
Being this is a public hearing, any more questions from the board? Well, being this is a public hearing,
oh,
is it?
I just have. Oh, okay. Did you? I remember at the planning board you were talking about parking and probably, possibly doing valet parking. Is that still in your plan? Or
you know, we're gonna play that by ear. Again, I'm not sure how that what ended up for the different differentiating the two lots, or mm-hmm. but I mean, we certainly may look at that.
Yeah. Okay.
That's definitely an option for us.
Hopefully that'll be a nice problem to have.
Sure would. Sure would.
We'll welcome that problem.
Yeah, absolutely.
One quick question. I looked at throughout the floor plan. You guys got a lot in such a small area. Some of the text is hard to read, but the second floor, no patrons up there. That's just coolers and
second
storage.
Floor? Yeah. Those are apartments.
Okay, so this...
That's actually the basement.
So that's the basement
yeah.
area. Okay,
yeah,
so
you might
stairs go down
the
to the basement.
Correct.
That's all the...
That's just storage.
No, okay.
That's all.
Will the restaurant be open while the apartments are being completed, or are they going to be complete? Everything going to be completed?
Oh,
the same
I think
time?
The apartments will be completed before the restaurant.
Oh.
Everything has to be completed at the same time.
Yeah.
Because I can't. The sprinkler has to be completely done. For the sprinkler to be done, it's got to be all wired, plumbed, insulated. So like the whole thing is really has to be done at one time. I'm ahead of him.
Yeah, I was going to say he's ahead of us.
Yeah.
Okay. It's all. Why,
and
that's as far as I know.
Okay.
I've just been waiting for the license.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any more questions?
Can I make a comment? It would be really nice to have a place when we have a meeting, like tonight,
mm-hmm.
downtown, that's open for dinner on our way to the meeting. we constantly struggle with there's nothing, you
there's
know.
Not a lot of places.
Well,
place
I don't think that's
going
to be a struggle anymore.
Yeah,
be happy.
Looking forward to it.
It's good.
Okay. Being this is a public hearing, is anybody in the audience that has any comments? Seeing none, can I have a motion to close the public hearing?
Move to close public hearing.
Second.
Chris is in the air.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion?
Seeing none, all those in favor? Okay, can we have a motion to
approve the application, so on and so forth?
Yeah, there's, can we do it under one motion, or you need three?
I would do three separate motions.
Okay, so we'll do the first one. Move to approve the application for an annual all-alcohol restaurant license.
Second.
I get this one.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Move to approve the application for a common victualer's license.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
And lastly, move to approve the application for entertainment license.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion?
Just under discussion, we have residential on top and entertainment down the bottom. The ones I'm familiar with, the people on top eventually complain about the people down below.
Sure.
How does that work out between the two entities?
The apartments are not above the main restaurant space.
So they won't be able to hear the entertainment?
They're above the kitchen, so.
Okay.
But that'll be disclosed too.
So they'll be thinking about the food as opposed to the.
Yeah, exactly.
Fair enough, thank you.
Sure.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Appreciate it.
Best of luck.
We'll see y'all soon.
All right.
Absolutely.
Good luck, Tim.
All moving forward. All right.
This new system.
Yes, very good.
Want to clarify so they can.
For Selectmen's update, I just had a, wanted to wish, hope everybody had a happy and safe new year. And I just want to follow up on the last meeting. This is more for Jim's benefit and anybody else's. When we discussed the goals for 2017. Just want to make sure that if any of the board has any topics that they think really need to get on agenda, just reach out to me or Bill, and we'll make sure we get it on as we kind of build our calendar for the year. And we'll see if we can hit target dates. So I think this calendar idea we should visit. If not every meeting, maybe every other meeting, just to make sure that we're not missing topics or falling behind on some of our target dates.
Okay.
So, you know, if we're going to do it, we should probably do it and follow up on it and make sure if we can hit our goals.
Right.
And if there's any time sensitive issues, let's get those scheduled ASAP. So that's all I had for update. If anybody has any other updates.
Just, Mr. Chairman, I think there's some people in the audience who are here for something that they thought was going to be on the agenda item tonight, and it's not. Because one of our selectmen is not in attendance.
Oh. Right.
So just to let you know, it, from what I understand, it would be at the next meeting.
Right, 24th.
Yeah, as of right now, it's going to be scheduled for the 24th.
Thanks.
I just didn't want you to be sitting in there.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sorry about that.
Sorry, one of my friends having a restaurant, so that's good.
There you go. So it wasn't a total loss.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Happy New Year.
Thanks, Jenny. Anybody else have any updates?
No.
Bill?
Okay, we got lots of things going on. Speaking of deadline calendar items, the issue that was starting to take some time on right now is the regional dispatch item. I'm just here to announce tonight that we are going to have a public presentation on this item on January 17th. It will be in Mansfield at the Mansfield Town Hall, which is a week from tonight, starting at 7 p.m. All four communities are going to be represented. All four boards will be represented at that meeting, so we'll be posting that as a regular meeting for this board.
And is that to listen, or is that a question and answer? Do we participate?
You'll have an opportunity to ask questions. The boards will, but I think the way I view this issue from it's this is a first opportunity for you to see this item. We're going to give you a lot of information that night. And then you'll have an opportunity to ask questions that night, but then I think you also want to vet it back here to hear from our own folks as well. But there are some things that we're working on locally. We're working with our dispatch group. I'm going to be working with our dispatch group, scheduling meetings with the chief, Chief Baker and Chief Hatfield about that, and meeting them with them to try to talk and try to answer as many questions as they have. We have invited them in the past. They have shown up at some of our meetings, our regional meetings, but they haven't shown up at all of them, so we want to make sure that we keep them fully informed.
So is the plan to have this public meeting with all four communities as a first pass?
Right.
And then is the board going to come to each community and address the board and the public directly?
Well, we have our own representatives here locally, so we can do that with our own team. And I think it's probably more particularly of interest to our own impacts locally.
Mm-hmm.
So I think our team would probably do that. I serve as chairman of the entire group, so I can probably answer a lot of those questions. But I think I think having our own resources here, I mean, we can get more here if you need them. That's not an issue. But all the police and fire personnel that have been working on this project since for 2 years now are going to be there at the meeting, along with some state. I'm not sure the state 911 people will be there. They're going to wait till after we all reach agreement on whether or not we want to be part of this and sign the agreement. Now, a couple of dates that are important for us. One is the fact that in February, though I think this is aggressive, I'm not sure we're going to be able to get this done, is there is a grant opportunity for looking at technology, which is available in the first week in February. The second one is the more important one, and that's in March. So March 1st, and where they're trying to get decisions made in each of the towns to go forward, because if we all go forward, we can then become eligible for state 911 funding to help start the initial steps of funding the center. The center itself will not be operational until 2019, but there's a lot of groundwork that needs to be done. In other words, we can go forward with hiring a director, executive director, with the state 911 funds, and they will fund that completely. And then we will be able then to start the process of, building the details around the actual center itself. So there's a lot of information that we've covered on this already, which I'm sure you'll be impressed by, but, the questions that we're dealing with right now are more the how we're going to handle the internal impacts in each of the towns and how we're going to handle those. Once the 911 center comes online, how are we going to handle our local calls? And we have a plan in Foxboro that we're going to be presenting to you, but and the other towns do too. But it's going to be different each town because of the way they handle it. So there's a lot to cover in the next 2 months. So I want to just. But that's going to have to be a high priority issue for us to deal with.
I'm sorry, Jenny.
No, okay. Go ahead.
And it's 7 o'clock.
Next Tuesday night at the Mansfield Town Hall, room 3A and B, which is the hearing room upstairs.
Okay. Bill, I know that the town of Hingham is part of a regional organization.
Yes, there's a four.
Are we going to have access to anyone from the town of Hingham or whoever is in that region to ask them questions, because they've experienced this?
Right. Mm-hmm. We've reached out to either Hingham or to other dispatch centers that are already up and running, and we're going to have actually a person be present at the meeting on the 17th.
Okay.
So they'll be able to answer some of those questions.
Could it be somebody from a selectman from Hingham who's been
sure.
who sat in the yeah. same seats we're sitting?
That's probably a good idea to get someone there.
Yeah.
Because I'm sure that they went through. We've learned from a lot of their mistakes,
mm-hmm.
so we should be in a better position than they were, because they were really the pioneers in doing this in this state, which is kind of interesting to find out that the one we've been learning about this is one of the last states in the country to do this. It's been really well adopted in other parts of the country for years. So we're looking at trying to really break that mold and get back into it, get into that process here. But I can tell you that the work between all four towns has been phenomenal. I mean, I can tell you the cooperation is terrific. Everybody's fully engaged. The manager's relationship has been tremendous. We've used each other's resources to try and pull the pieces together. We meet on a regular basis to talk about all the concerns, how we're going to deal with the issues that pop up. It's been a really, really good process. really good process. So, not without challenges, I'm sure. We're gonna find what those challenges are. We know, and we have an idea as to what some of those are, but we're gonna try and address as many as we can.
Well, it's nice if you have some, if you have like someone from Hingham, and they can explain why things were done a certain way, and what they found worked, what didn't work, and just kind of give us an idea of what to expect.
Well, I know that the fire and police personnel have already done that. I wasn't involved in that. They actually, they did that research before I became part of the overall process. So they can relate that information, but they also have reached out to them to see if either, it was either there or one other place that we've asked to come and speak to that particular issue, particularly have the on the communication side, how that works. So for the people, I have a good understanding of that. Okay.
Bill, are there any towns that have tried this and then backed out and it did not work?
there is one in particular, but I'm not sure they actually started or they did it, and that was in, I think, Beverly. Where they joined and then they just backed away and they just never decided not to do it, and they never actually participated in it. But then it became a bit of a challenge. So the question's of course going to come up, like, well, what's going to happen if you decide you want to back out? Well, what'll typically happen, we think is that's going to happen is that this is going to be the model that's going to continue to evolve over time, and you'll probably be asked to go to someone else's 911 center at that point, because what's happened is that the 911 money is drying up. They're only going to fund these regional centers. They're not going to fund local cities and towns anymore, because it's just not the most economical way to do that. So I don't want to steal the thunder from the presentation, but I think a lot of those questions can answer. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so that was issue number one. The second thing is electric aggregation. They're moving forward with the public education piece of that. That'll be starting as early as next week. You'll start and see information going out, and we'll be sending stuff to individual homes. We'll be offering opportunity for people to, I'll be going on TV to do another presentation on that, and so the public communication piece. I know that Caitlin's been working. We'll be working with them too. There's a piece on our website about that. We'll provide all the information that people need for becoming involved in that. Another thing that we're working on that's really exciting too is the streetlight project, where we're acquiring all our streetlights, and then we're going to be retooling them with LED lights. The financing piece of that is being finalized, and we have another meeting on that tomorrow or Thursday, and we're looking to finalize the financing of that, but we should be able to pay less money than we're paying now to actually own them and then finance the new lights as well.
On the lights and the poles, or just the lights?
Just the lights themselves. Just the lights. Yeah, the poles still belong to National Grid or Verizon, either one. And then, last but not least, really exciting opportunity here that's presented itself to us. just as yesterday, we've been working on this for a while, but we were notified yesterday that Northeastern University has awarded us a capstone project, and it'll be working with Professor Dan Dolaski. And this is a summary of that I have to give credit to Paige Duncan for putting the summary together. It says that students in the School of Public Policy and Urban Affairs at Northeastern University complete their degree requirements by participating in a group capstone project in conjunction with the in-service to a public or nonprofit sector partner. These projects are research-based and client-oriented analysis, which in the end are applied by the client to the issue at hand. Projects typically focus on problems that clients want to address, which they neither have the time nor resources to pursue given given other priorities. Areas of focus range broadly, encompassing issues of urban and regional policy, e.g. transit-oriented development, housing and sustainability, social policy, e.g. workforce development, community service, urban education, health, etc. In public and nonprofit sector management, such as strategic planning, budgeting, and program evaluation. Students work in 3 to 5 person teams over the course of 15 weeks, supervised by faculty in the school, and conclude with the presentations to the clients. Faculty and fellow students project teams are comprised of students in master's programs in urban and regional policy, public administration, and urban informatics, who will have had a core training in policy analysis, research methods, statistics, and to varying degrees, more specialized skills such as cost of benefit analysis, program evaluation, data visualization, and survey research in GIS. Just yesterday, Professor Dan Dolaski
of Northeastern University informed us that Route 1 Foxborough has been selected as their civil engineering capstone project for the year. The project will comprise of a multidisciplinary team including environmental, structural, transportation engineers, and architects. No stone will be left unturned. However, the focus of the design will highlight the following. Possible development on the west side of Route 1. The architects and structural engineers will identify building types, styles, and reinforcing approaches that could be used for vetting. The environmental and transportation engineers will provide guidance on stormwater management and site layout. On Route 1, the transportation engineers will take the lead on the section that will span from town line to town line. The engineers will identify opportunities to make the roadway more permeable east to west and west to east, as well as approaches that may calm traffic through the village, incorporate other modes to safely and address game day traffic. So this is a tremendous opportunity. This work here is worth several thousand dollars that we're getting for free Northeastern University. All we have to do is provide them some food and cover some of their expenses. But it's a tremendous opportunity. We've used them before. I used them before in another community that I worked in, and it was a tremendous project and a tremendous result that we continue to use throughout the time that I was there. So I'm really excited that we're able to get this and grateful that we get this opportunity for the town. So with that, I think that's all I have for now. I've got a few other things I'm working on, but not ready for prime time yet. Right?
Yep, I just have a few things. Bill and I have been meeting with department heads and Randy on budgets. So our cycle is, we're pre-meeting before they go to and present to the AdCom. So it's always a really good information and chance to bond with the department heads over what their needs might be. So we continue to proceed with that. Tomorrow night is DPW and Historical Commission budgets. On Thursday, we're holding our kickoff to the IAC, which is the Insurance Advisory Committee. It's all of the unions, town and school. We'll be doing a presentation. Bill and I will kick it off, and then we have Blue Cross coming. We have legal counsel who is going to tell us about how we engage in the negotiation process for next year's health insurance. There's certain steps because we adopted Chapter 32B, Sections 21 through 23, so there's like these timelines we have to follow. So we'll be presenting that, and there's also a mitigation discussion. There was money left from the last agreement that should be shared by employees, and we're going to discuss with the union groups how to do that. So it's really the first step in organizing to engage in negotiations with the idea that, everybody wants to save money on health insurance, and our plan year starts September 1. It's never too early to kick off and start talking about it. So this will be the kickoff to that. We also, Bill and I will be attending next week the MMA conference in Boston. It's a Friday, Saturday conference. I think you have to go earlier because you're on the board. Mm-hmm. And that's where we also attend the Maya lunch, where the town is usually recognized for a safety award and receives Maya credits. And then finally, we'll be meeting tomorrow with the Safe Foxboro Committee. That's our former opioid task force, and the group's been doing a lot of work. Caitlin's helping us out now with a web presence on this on the page, and we're serving as a clearinghouse for resources for all types of opioid situations that might our community members might encounter. So we'll have resources for school age people, stuff for law enforcement. So we're collecting all of that data, and we'll be debuting the website to you at a future meeting. That's all I have.
Okay. Oh, I got a question. Are we going to have a year in review for 2016?
We talked about like that. Yes, we did last year. We talked about that.
We're hoping for the next meeting.
Just curious.
Yeah, because it's good to do that because it gives, it's really easy to forget all the things that we did, but it's really important that we review them and show that what we've accomplished during the past year.
Caitlin's helping us pull together some pictures.
Ooh, slideshow.
Yeah. So that's possibly on the next agenda.
And for those interested, the flag will be back Thursday. We hope in the center of town. That's why I've been promised that, weather permitting, of course. And Friday's the weather day, if in case it doesn't work. But right now, the weather looks good for both Thursday and Friday.
Good news. Okay. Action items?
All right. Number one, move to approve tuition reimbursement for Officer Kenneth Fitzgerald in the amount of $2,652.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Move to approve the New England Patriots Charitable Foundation, a two-day all-alcohol liquor license for January 14th playoff game and possibly the AFC Championship game on January 22nd.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Go Pats.
On Saturday.
Go Pats.
Move to accept a gift donation in the amount of $300 to the Council on Aging for a program agreed upon in advance from the Friends of Foxborough Seniors.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Move to approve a one-day wine and malt beverage license for Fairway Independent Mortgage Company for February 2nd, 2017.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye. Move to approve a common Vic license for Foxborough VFW.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor?
Aye. Move to approve a gift donation in the amount of $10,000 to the Boyden Library Trustees for either the procurement of books, materials, or computers, Kindles, for the Children's Library or the Main Library.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion?
Just a point of clarification. Normally, the board wouldn't do this because the library trustees usually accept these gifts on their own. But due to the significance of this gift, we really wanted to make sure that the public was aware of it. So it was we're really much greatly appreciated.
Mm-hmm.
No further discussion. All those in favor?
Aye. Move to accept a gift donation in the amount of $97.50 to the Council on Aging for services from Maureen Krause.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor?
Aye. Should we split these or do them the meetings?
The minutes?
The minutes together.
Yeah, you can do them together.
Okay. Move to approve the Board of Selectmen minutes for 11/1/16 and 12/27/16.
Was everybody here, though, for both of those?
Yeah, I wasn't here for the second one, but I did. No, actually, I didn't because it's not on cable. So you're going to have to separate them or I'll have to recuse myself.
All right. Retract that motion.
Don't
we'll
go
start
away
again.
Well, you guys didn't even talk about anything
for the
last meeting. 15 minutes long.
Should you learn here?
Move to approve the Board of Selectmen minutes for 11/1/16.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye. Move to approve the Board of Selectmen minutes for 12/27/16.
Second.
Motion made, second. And because nothing was said.
It wasn't even controversial.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I recuse myself.
All right. And a motion to... Oh, wait. Barra.
I knew we wouldn't get away. We couldn't get away scot-free tonight, right?
Nope. So it's actually just what most of the clarifications are actually about the regional dispatch thing. Mm-hmm. You said four communities. I thought we were regionalizing with three.
No, there were four.
Four.
With four total.
Four total. Excellent.
Three. Three others beside ourselves.
Okay. Yeah. Excellent. So it's us, Mansfield, Norton, and
Easton.
Easton. Right. Okay. Easton. And the group that's going to be giving the presentation, you said you're a part of it, or you're a part of our...
The chairman of the committee.
You're the chairman of the committee that will
right.
be giving a presentation.
Right.
Excellent. And what's the formal name of the group that's presenting?
It's the Regional Managers and Communications Committee Working Group.
Excellent. Regional Managers and Communications Working
Regional,
Group.
Regional Emergency
Communications Center Working Group.
Regional Emergency Communications Center Working Group.
Otherwise known as the REC. RECC.
The RECC, great. And how many members are on the RECC?
That's a good question. I never really count them up. I think there's probably at least 15, so.
Excellent. And someone from Hingham, a selectman from Hingham may be there?
We haven't formally made that request, but I think that somebody, the communications person, may be there, but we'll reach out and see if we can get somebody to come.
Great. Excellent. That's about everything that I need. Everyone have a lovely one.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bear. Motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Good night, everybody.
Time being 8:05.